I want to thank Batsy and Michal for doing this wonderful event. It's very, very important. You know, I always say that, you know, that we should definitely bring all the pro-Israel activists together and that we should all work very, very hard, especially now, because now really time is of the essence. Just so you know about who I am, I used to work for the Likud. I was a parliamentary assistant for Ayub Kara, who was a Jews minister at the time in Negev in the Galilee. Then I worked with the Hasbara Ministry during Operation Cast Lead and the two flotilla incidents that happened. And, you know, I've been to all the different conferences in New York. I did major rallies against media bias towards Israel with over 3,000 people in front of CNN. On Facebook, I have about 18,000 pro-Israel activists constantly joining with the different groups that I've been doing and talking about the various issues. Yesterday, I went to a major conference on the missile defense platforms between America and Israel. And of course, the topic of the day was Iran and the upcoming nuclear deal. And by the way, to answer your question about the Iranian threat, and the best answer I can give, which I didn't hear yet, but I also came late, so maybe it came before I got here, is Yemen. What's going on in Yemen is a small microcosm what Iran will bring to the world, and what the Arabs, by the way, will do if or when Iran gets the bomb. What's going on in Yemen is very simple. The Saudis and the Egyptians have had enough of Iran trying to take over covertly the Middle East. You know, they're trying to interfere in Syria, they're trying to interfere in Iraq, they're trying to give Hezbollah and Hamas as much advanced weaponry as possible. And they're trying to supply the Houthis in Yemen to take over Yemen and control the oil passageway in the south. And what happened is that Egypt and Saudi Arabia and a few other Gulf countries and Jordan said they had enough. The West wasn't doing anything. And they sent in their troops. And now there's intense fighting between the Saudis and the Gulf versus the Iranian Houthi rebels. And this, by the way, is the big problem with Iran. That the minute that Iran becomes not a nuclear state, but a nuclear threshold country, all of the Middle Eastern countries will start panicking. When they go into that panic mode, that is what Israel is very worried about. Because when that panic mode happens, Israel will not be the only country in the Middle East that brings in nuclear weapons. Every other country will try to get nuclear weapons. Saudi Arabia has a secret agreement with Pakistan. Egypt is trying to get Russia to help them now. So there's two issues dealing with Iran. One is, you know, the threat of them just wanting to have the bomb. The other threat is them actually having the bomb, which will, you know, which actually, by the way, deathly scares the Arab world, because the Arabs are divided between two camps, and the Shiites and the Sunnis. Iran is Shiites, most of the Middle East is Sunni, led by Saudi Arabia, and they've been sworn enemies since. It has to do with what happened to, you know, it's very simple. You know, I always like to say this, where did Judaism went right, and where did Islam went wrong? It's very simple. We had a national leader who took us out of Egypt. And this Friday we're celebrating the holiday, Passover. Moses, when Moses, right before he died, he did something very smart that Muhammad didn't do. And this is what's caused to the problems to this day, is that Moses appointed a successor. He told the Israelites, Joshua will lead you into ancient Israel, you know, and he will you will vanquish the Canaanites, and Israel will become your home. When Muhammad passed away, he didn't leave a successor. So there's competing sects now about who is the rightful heir to Muhammad. And that, by the way, is the core problem with the Sunnis and the Shiites, and there is various other sub-categories in Islam. The second issue, by the way, that I just want to say, the biggest difference between Judaism, Christianity, and Islam is that if you read our religious texts, our enemies are dead. Our enemies were the Canaanites, the Moabites, the Edomites. These are all the tribes of the Middle East. They no longer exist anymore. In Islam, the enemy of Islam still exists to this day, which is Judaism and Christianity. Why? Because we were the ones that said no to Muhammad. And by the way, you can see this very well, and I read the Quran, and you can see that there are certain parts of the Quran where Jews are very favorable, or looked very favorably upon. And then there are switches that Jews are snakes and we're liars and thieves. You should throw a rock at us. And so what exactly happened? You know, why were you one time good and then next time bad? Is that Muhammad's best friends were Jews. When the, you know, there was a Jewish tribes in Saudi Arabia during Muhammad's time. Before he got the revelation from the angel Gabriel, many of his friends were Jews. He was a merchant, so he dealt in the business world. You know, after he decided to become a prophet, the Jews, of course, rejected him as a prophet and said, "No, we cannot accept you as a prophet." The minute that that rejection happened, Muhammad and his followers declared war on the Jews, and they vanquished the Jews of Saudi Arabia. To this day, there is no more Jews left of Saudi Arabia. Then that started the whole concept of the dhimmis, the second-class citizens, which brings me into the last thing that I'm very much involved in, and which I do, by the way, believe that in Israel alone, they should have this, is the Jews from the Arab world. I believe that there should be a Yad Vashem for Jews from the Arab world, but not a small section. There should be an actual building that talks about the history, the culture, and the traditions of the Jews from the Arab world. Because even the Jewish people who come from the Arab world don't know the history, don't know the culture. You know, for example, the Jews of Yemen are actually there pre-Islamic times. I mean, were there probably since when Babylon was an empire at the time. That they were one of the core, you know, foundations of Judaism, including Iraq and Iran, which was Persia and Babylon at the time. But nobody really knows that the Jews were there before. We know that Daesh, ISIS, by the way, is demolishing Jewish, you know, graves, tombstones, synagogues, you name it, in Syria and Iraq, and nobody talks about it. You know, but it is a major catastrophe. And I know some of these stuff very well because the chief of staff of Ayub Kara at the time, he's Druze, he has a lot of his Druze compatriots in Syria, and they send him photographs of this of the Syrian rebels and the destruction that Daesh is doing to the various Jewish sites, which is a tragedy that nobody talks about. And so this, you know, I really do think, so my goal now is two things. First, I do think that there should be a big pro-Israel presence, you know, now, you know, against Iran now, because now really the time is of the essence. The, you know, Obama desperately wants to sign an agreement with Iran. Obama believes that since Iran is a strong military regional player, you know, therefore it can be a stabilizing force. He's wrong. Iran wants to take over the Middle East, and by the way, the world too. Therefore, it wouldn't be building intercontinental ballistic missiles that can reach Europe and America, you know, unless if you want to make cupcakes out of them, you know. But, you know, so I think that there should be a big pro-Israel presence in Israel, because it starts here, you know, and that we can show the world exactly, you know, what it, you know, why are Israelis scared, you know, what is the big problem with Iran? Because no one really understands it, because, you know, ISIS is taking the spotlight with their chopping beheadings and burning Jordanian pilots, sadly, you know. And the last thing is, you know, I think that people should become more engaged, either on social media, you know, on campuses, whatever, people to people. You know, now, temporarily, I'm working at the Dan Hotel in Tel Aviv. This is the last thing I'm going to say. On Frischman Street, and I'm meeting people, of course, from all over the world, and of course, you know, many times they ask me, so what about Netanyahu? What's really going on between Obama and Netanyahu? Why is Netanyahu making a big stink about Iran? I think I heard that 10 times in 1 week, you know. So people don't really understand the threat, and they don't understand the threat because Iran is very clever. You know, they're so clever that they can fool the world. You know, and that is the big problem, that we have to, you know, twist their deception. You know, I mean, yes, you know, they can be polite and they can say that, you know, we want peace and we deserve nuclear energy. But the real question is, why do you want it? And that's what they don't tell the world. You know, they give some, you know, distorted view of why they want it. So on this note, you know, I just want to thank again Michal and Batsi again for all of, you know, this wonderful gathering. feel free to add me on Facebook if you want. I'll give you my contact information, and Chag Sameach.